Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, we are going to use again conditioning techniques to solve a very popular problem in probability theory called the ballot problem. So here it is. We assume that in an election there are two candidates that we call A and B. We assume that candidate capital A receive little a votes. Same thing for B, capital B receives small b votes. And we assume that A wins the election, so meaning that little a is strictly larger than little b. Now, the goal of the problem is obviously not to compute the probability that A wins. This is something that we know already. The goal is to find the probability that we are going to call PAB, that candidate A is always ahead of B. So, obviously, this is going to depend on the ordering of the voters. It depends on the order in which the voters voted for each of the two candidates. And we are going to assume, for simplification, of course, that all the possible orderings of the voters are equally likely. So that means that because you have A plus B voters, that gives you A plus B factorial possible number of orders. In which the voters went to vote, and we assume that all those A plus B factorial possible orderings are equally likely. So, this problem is a little bit tricky, so maybe I'm going to start by drawing a picture to show you how it works. So, first you can, this picture is just a picture of the event that indeed A is always ahead of B, and just looking at this picture, we can make sense of what's going on here. So, so first you start at time zero, and I'm going to draw basically the total number of votes A got minus the total number of votes B got. And we know that eventually A wins, so, and we know that eventually this average is going to be equal to A minus B. Now, at each time step, so here we wait until voter A plus B to go to vote. So we have, in some sense, A plus B time steps. You can think of that as time steps. And so at each time step, you can go up and down. But you know that, of course, to go from zero to this point, you need to go up A times and you need to go down B times. Okay, and so you might go down at first and then go back up, but in which case you are not in this event that A is always ahead of B. The event that A is always ahead of B means that this kind of trajectory should always be above this horizontal axis. So I'm going to draw a picture of that, so maybe it will look like this. Then you go down a little bit, down again, and then up, up, down and up here again. Okay, so that's, for instance, a picture that would tell you, well, if the first one, two, three voters voted for A, and then you have one guy voted for B, and so on. And so that's how you interpret this picture. And we want, basically, to compute the probability that this trajectory with A segments going up and B segments going down, when all the possible orderings of the segments are equally likely, we want to compute the probability that this trajectory is always above this horizontal axis. So now it turns out that the result can be proved by induction, but of course to prove the result by induction, you kind of need to know the answer, and then you can deduce that. So I'm going to give you the answer, but the answer is kind of intuitively, I mean, it kind of makes sense, and this gives you a very, very nice, simple formula that says that the probability that this trajectory is always above the horizontal axis is just A minus B divided by A plus B. So the goal is to prove by induction that the probability we are looking for, PAB, is equal to A minus B divided by A plus B. You see that this formula makes sense, at least in terms of monotonicity. Of course, I'm not saying that it's obvious that the answer is this, but it's intuitively the answer makes sense. if A minus B is small, meaning that A didn't get much more vote than B, of course it's less likely that this happens. It's reflected in this this numerator here, and clearly for A minus B fixed, if the number of votes is very very large, then that gives more opportunity to this line to go below the horizontal axis. And so that's why we kind of divide by this A plus B. It's just to tell you that this formula kind of intuitively makes sense. So now to prove this by induction, so of course first step is to prove that indeed it's true when A plus B is equal to 1. So I didn't say by induction on what, but here we are going to assume that the result is true for A plus B equals 1, 2, 3 up to some number, and then we want to prove at the next step. So that's going to be by induction on A plus B, the total number of voters. You see, if you have only one voter, then the only possibility is that A is equal to 1 and B is equal to 0. There is only one vote. We know that A wins. So that means A equals 1, B equals 0. In this case, A equals 1, B equals 0 gives you 1 over 1. That's 1. Indeed, if there is only one vote, it's clear that and A wins, then it's clear that A is always ahead of B. That's the only possibility. So now, to prove the result by induction. So the idea here is that we could exactly, I mean, using a conditioning, we could exactly, like in the previous videos, like condition on what happens at step one. But it's easy to see here in this case that it's not going to give you anything, because if you condition on what happens at step one, that can be a segment going up or a segment going down, but your segment going down is excluded, because if the first border votes for B, then clearly, well, your event that A is always ahead of B is not going to happen. And so the only possibility for the first segment is going up. So now it turns out that to prove this by induction, what is going to work well is to condition not on who gets the first vote, but at the opposite, who gets the last vote. And that's on that we are going to condition. So to write this into, to turn this into equation, I'm going to introduce a few events. So we are going to condition on those events. So let's say A is the event that candidate A gets the last vote. Then same story for B. We are going to call B the event that candidate B gets the last vote. And the event of interest, I'm going to call that, for instance, A plus, to say A is always above B. Okay, the number of votes for A is always larger than the number of votes for B at any time, not only at the end, but at any time. So I'm going to introduce this other event. So A plus is the event that A is always ahead of B. And so using this, eventually we can write that P of A plus. So again, I'm going to use a conditioning. So I'm going to use here the partition AB. You see that A, the two events A and B form indeed a partition of omega, because well, the last vote, that's either A or B who gets it, that has to be one of the two, but that cannot be both at the same time. So that means that indeed those two events are mutually exclusive and their union is equal to omega. So we can indeed apply the formula that we saw before, but on here just with a partition with only two events. And that's going to tell you that P of A plus is just P of A plus given A times P of A plus P of A plus given B times P of B. Okay, so after, those two probabilities are not difficult to compute, having in mind that all the possible permutations of the borders are equally likely. So you have to really think not in terms of all the possible permutations, but what happens at the last vote, and saying that all the possible orderings are equally likely. That means that the probability that the last vote is for A should be exactly equal to the proportion of votes that are for A, which is A divided by A plus B. So in this case, it kind of makes sense. I mean, you have a possible, I mean, at the end, you have a up or down segment. We don't know what it is, but there is a total of A up segments. There is a total of B down segments. And this assumption on the fact that those all those A plus B factorial possible permutations are equally likely also tell you that that at any position you are going to see an up segment with probability A divided by A plus B. So number of up segments divided by the total number of segments. Yeah. So that means that this P of A is equal to A divided by A plus B. And similarly, this one is B divided by A plus B. They indeed add up to one. That's normal because those two events form a partition of the sample space. So that means that this is equal to A divided by A plus B times P of A plus given A plus so we said B divided by A plus B times the probability of A plus, so A is always ahead of B, but given this time, then B gets the last vote. So now what we need to do is express those conditional probabilities. Those ones are not easy to compute, but it turns out that we know what they are. Why? Because we are going to assume that, but at the previous time step. So that's what we want to prove, but we already know that it's true when A plus B is equal to 1, in which case, because A is strictly larger than B, that means A equals 1 and B equals 0, and we are going to assume that it's true for all coefficients here, number of votes, such that the sum is strictly less than A plus B. And it turns out that if you know who gets the last vote, then the conditional probability here just becomes the probability that A was always ahead of B up to time A plus B minus 1. And so because of this minus 1, and that's the reason why you condition on the last vote, is so that we can go one time step earlier. And because of this one time step earlier, we can indeed use induction. So our assumption here, and so in this case, that's going to tell you that this probability should be A divided by A plus B. So, and then this one is exactly, so we have an up segment at the end, that's the picture here, and then that means A was always ahead of B should by definition be the probability that A was always ahead of B up to that time. But at that time, A got A minus 1 votes and B got B votes, okay? So here, this conditional probability, in fact, is just P of A minus 1, comma B, okay? Because just before the last vote, A only got A minus 1 votes because A got the last vote. So that you have indeed an A here, eventually, you need A minus 1 votes just before the last vote. Same story for this conditional probability, that's A plus B divided by A plus B times P of A, but this time B minus 1, because B gets the last vote, so that means that just before the last vote, B got B minus 1 vote. So now that's when we use this formula here, so I don't really need this anymore. So you remember that's P of A plus that we are computing here. So we are done with those calculations. So now we can say that P of A plus, so P of A plus is equal to, so this term here, so A divided by A plus B. Now, if we use this assumption, but again, That's what we want to prove, but here you see that the sum of the total number of votes in those two cases is equal to A plus B minus 1, so we can indeed use this formula. And then that's going to tell you that the probability here should be equal to A minus 1 minus B divided by A plus B minus 1. So here we have eventually some A minus B minus 1 divided by A plus B minus 1. That's for this first conditional probability here. And then for the second one, we get B divided by A plus B times. And so here, we have a minus B minus 1. So we have the same as this term, except that we have a plus here. So that gives you A minus B plus 1 divided by A plus B minus 1. Again, those two terms are the same. They represent the total number of votes. We are one time step earlier, so that's indeed A plus B minus 1. Here, at the opposite, we have minus 1 plus 1 because that depends on who gets the last vote. So, we are done now with all the math, and I should say all the reasoning based on logic with induction and also probability theory. The last step is just to do some basic calculation. So you see that in this case, there is a common denominator here that corresponds to the total number of votes, if there is, you know, in the original case of A plus B voters, times the total number of votes just at the previous time step, which is A plus B minus 1. So we have this term in denominator, so A plus B times A plus B minus 1. And then in the numerator, so you see that on both sides there is an A minus B, okay, that we can put in factor and with an A plus B here. So eventually you get A plus B times A minus B. Okay, that takes everything into account except this minus 1 and plus 1 here. So you still have to put some minus A and plus B here. So you see that this minus A plus B is the same as the minus A minus B, so that's, you can put it in factor with this term, and so eventually you get A plus B minus 1 times A minus B. Okay, so here what I'm doing is that we have again this A plus B times A minus B appears here, A plus B times A minus B, but then minus 1 times A minus B, which is minus 1 plus B, that corresponds to this term here, you divide by the same denominator, A plus B times A plus B minus 1, and you see that we have a simplification. This simplifies with this one, and we end up with A minus B divided by A plus B. So, in conclusion, you see, if we do this conditioning based on a partition, now the partition is just two events. In this case, that's interesting. To prove the result by induction, we need to condition not on what happens at the beginning, but what happens at the end, for the last vote here. And you see that if we assume, clearly this is true when A plus B is equal to 1. If we assume that this formula is true for all A plus B strictly less than N, and then we do this reasoning when A plus B is equal to N, then by replacing by the correct expression here and here, we indeed get that the probability of A plus, which is exactly PAB when we have A plus B voters, is going to be equal to A minus B divided by A plus B, so that indeed proves the formula here.